In the past, AMD partner Sapphire's Nitro Plus cards have been associated with bigger coolers and higher-end SKUs. For example, there wasn't a 5600 XT, but for this generation, there's actually a 6600 XT Nitro Plus card. And is this one that much better compared to the less flashy Pulse card? Let's take a look. Walking machines and more. If you've been shopping for a GPU, the 6600 XT has been one of the more satisfying and refreshing launches, since you can actually get stock at least reasonably easy enough, and still today it's not terribly difficult to buy. They were on shelves for quite a while on launch day, and the prices right now are a little bit higher than MSRP, supply has tightened up a little bit, but they've stabilized around 500, 550 or so. And for a lot of you, yeah, from a percentage standpoint, it's still quite a bit more than the Phantom MSRP of 380. But from a dollar perspective, the premium is a lot lower than on other cards, right? It's only like 100, 125 bucks. And that's easier to justify if you absolutely need a card for your build right now. As a reviewer that gets these cards on the second round for reviews, I'm getting to check out these cards after the first round. Launch day reviewers have gotten them and test them out, so there's less value that I can offer you in that benchmark arena. So instead of telling you what you probably know already in terms of the gaming performance, I thought that another way that I could add value and inject some interesting facts into the discussion is just to look at the differences between these two cards and compare contrast these two models. You might be in a situation where you can actually choose from either of these two cards when stock does appear. So for my review of the 6600 XT, I'm gonna focus on that comparison and also share some data for performance between these two cards compared to a few other cards. And then I'll wrap up with my overall impression of the series. So Navi 23 6600 XT, that's the so-called entry-level card in AMD's RX 6000 series, and it's the replacement for the Navi 10 5600 XT, which was one of my favorite cards in the previous generation, just because of its spectacular performance per dollar. The 6600 XT follows in that same trend, and the general performance is slightly above that of a 5700 XT. However, it's way more efficient. And that also means a small card, small coolers, those are the norm here. Now this is the closest I've ever seen Nitro Plus and the Pulse models when both are available in the same series. Typically the Nitro Plus cards are three fan models, so I really was intrigued by the difference here, since on the outside they look really similar. They're both dual fan, two slot designs. Now, the Pulse card I have here is a review unit from Sapphire. I already did some thermal testing with this that you might have seen on the NR200P Max optimization video, so big thanks to them for their support. And the Nitro Plus card here, I just purchased myself for my own build coming up soon, so let's just take a quick look here. Both have a metal backplate with a semi-flow-through cooler cutout, and it's just a small notch past the PCB, a single 8-pin power port, and the Nitro Plus has RGB, and with that comes a 3-pin DRGB port that theoretically can communicate to downstream devices, and a 3-position toggle switch, which enables a software-controlled vBIOS plus 2 manually selectable vBIOS modes. For the two switchable vBIOSes, there's a quieter silent and there's a performance mode. On the coolers themselves, these heatsinks look remarkably similar, and I wouldn't be surprised if they're the exact same one. But the fans, even though they look alike, they're a little bit different. The Nitro Plus ones do spin in opposing directions, presumably to create a different turbulence pattern. And I don't know necessarily that that matters too much when we take a look at the thermal differences, but on paper, the game clock of the Nitro Plus is 2548 megahertz versus 2382 on the Pulse, but does it really matter? For an extended Hefn 4.0 run, the Pulse is actually boosting to a higher clock, about 50 megahertz above the Nitro Plus in its performance mode. And as you can see, the silent vBIOS on the Nitro Plus just clocks in lower. The total board power in the silent mode is about 130 watts, while that figure is around 140 for both the Pulse and Nitro Plus in performance mode. The coolers boost fans up to between 1000 and 1300 RPM at the 25 degrees C room temp I tested in. The Pulse is more aggressive here, and the silent vBIOS definitely runs at a more consistent lower level, and it doesn't need to run as high since that VBIOS is drawing less power. I don't see a compelling reason to run the card in the silent BIOS. Personally, what I would do is just run it into the performance mode to get the full boost clock and then just dial back the fans, let the card run a little bit hotter if you want. And I think at that point, the performance hit will still be less than that gap that you see here. At the end of the day, the Pulse card does run a bit cooler due to the higher fan speeds. It is also louder, of course, by about 0.3 decibels. It's just a smidgen though, because these coolers are both very quiet, and these are refreshingly low RPMs for a graphics card these days. And let's just take a quick listen to what these sound like. Alright, so let's take a look at a few benchmarks. Apologies, I don't have access to a 3060, otherwise I would have just thrown that in there as a comparison. But let's just compare to the 6700 XT that I tested a few months back, and also the card that the 6600 XT is replacing, which is the 5600 XT. For the Heaven benchmark in 1440p, the two cards are pretty closely positioned. The Pulse is edging out the Nitro Plus here. For the 4K optimized benchmark in superposition, again, small margin here between the two cards, but the Pulse leads. Same story here with 3D Mark's TimeSpy Extreme. Cutting over to 3D Mark Port Royal, the 5600 XT is dropped here because it can't ray trace, but just to give an idea of where these cards stack up, I threw the 3070 FE's score in here. Now, these cards wouldn't be a good choice for ray tracing titles. For that, I'd look more towards the 3060 and 3060 Ti in this performance bracket. Of course, if anything, either of these are better than the 5600 XT in that regard, since that card's not equipped for RT at all. Finally, for the synthetics, a quick check over on 3D Mark Firestrike. The Pulse is, again, still ahead slightly. A title like Civ 6 would be fine even in 4K. For these two cards, but let's just do 1440p. And that 50-ish megahertz advantage the Pulse has over the Nitro Plus does translate into something not very meaningful for this title, but it is a 3 FPS advantage. But in something like Red Dead 2, that difference is inconsequential. And these two cards are basically identical in performance at this level. Now, I personally wouldn't be playing even in 1080 Ultra at these frame rates, but that's just to keep things consistent between all the cards tested. If you do drop settings to around medium, you'll see around 60 FPS in 1440 and 80 FPS in 1080, so very playable as long as you're willing to drop settings a little bit. And I think for most AAA titles, this is fine as long as you're realistic with your settings. For a rendering task, these cards are still pretty similar. Minute 2-second advantage here for the Pulse. So this Pulse card, pretty impressive. It's actually running a little bit better than the Nitro Plus. It's supposed to be kind of slightly lower than. If you want to mess with the Nitro Plus though, of course you could just throw a little more power at it and overclock it a little bit and get the same performance, just, you know, dial up the fan speeds. But yeah, out of the box, the Pulse is looking like the better performer here. Now, it's impossible to predict retail pricing, especially in this current market now, but at least Micro Center's site gives us a little indication of that the difference between these two cards is a mere $20. So what are you getting for the extra 20 bucks on the Nitro Plus? Well, at the end of the day, it looks like it's just RGB and an arguably better looking cooler. Now that's subjective, but for many of you, I think this might be totally worth it because of that. But suffice to say, the Pulse version performs every bit as good as the Nitro Plus. And hey, if you don't need the RGB, at least you know you're not giving away performance and you're also saving a few bucks. And likewise, for just $20, you're not really getting better performance, but I personally do like the looks of the Nitro card a little bit better. And I think I'll be throwing this Nitro Plus card into a medium powered sub 10 liter build soon, so we'll see how it performs there. Now, overall, I really like the 6600 XT series. I really like the 5600 XT, and for a lot of folks like myself, I don't need too much card, and at full load, this thing is drawing under 140 watts. So it's perfect for those medium-powered, small form factor builds, both from a compact size perspective and also from a heat management perspective. Now, even if the performance is coming in at the previous gen's 5700 XT level, I didn't like those big heavy coolers. The 5700 XT was drawing upwards of 225 watts. and a lot of the dual fan versions just ran way too loud, like the MSI Mech OC that I had for a while. You can't get a 5700 XT right now for a reasonable price just due to Ethereum mining, but if this is the level of gaming performance that you need, now you can get it in a very small, lean and quiet form. And I think that's the beauty here of the 6600 XT. Sure, it's definitely on the lower end of the performance spectrum right now, but when you consider that you can actually get either of these cards for a reasonable price given the current market, for example, at least right now in late September, a 3060 is gonna run you about $100 more than either of these cards on the market, if you can even find one, right? If you need ray tracing and DLSS, I would steer you towards Team Green's direction, but hey, if you're like me and you just wanna kick back and enjoy some RTS titles with the occasional AAA title, and you don't want to turn your desk into a small furnace, these cards are a breath of fresh air. And I'd say as long as you can get one for around 500 bucks, definitely go for it. And I'd wholeheartedly recommend these over a used previous gen GPU. I hope you found the information and the review enjoyable. If so, give a like. I'll also be leaving links for the cards and also other test components down below. Please check those out and please subscribe if you haven't already. Thanks for watching.